Good evening, everyone. I welcome you all to the AOI Association of Otolaryngologists of India lecture web series, Basics to Advanced Certificate course. And today, the topic centers on thyroid, and we have very eminent faculties, Dr. Pai from Tata Memorial, and Dr. Mohanty from MGM Healthcare, Chennai. So I first invite our moderator, Dr. Haritosh Velankar, who is a professor of ENT in D.Y. Patil Medical College. Sir has been earlier the head of department in D.Y. Patil Medical College, and he has been very active in AOI also. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Yogesh, for having me here. And thank you, AOI. And we'll be actually having a nice, interesting topic about thyroid. And the first speaker, what we are going to have is Dr. Sanjeev Mohanty. So let me just introduce him for everyone. He actually doesn't require any introduction, but since we are here on a webinar and there is a lot of following here, young students who may not be knowing him, for him, Professor Dr. Sanjeev Mohanty, currently he is a senior consultant in the Institute of ENT and Head and Neck, MGM Healthcare, Chennai. And he is a senior consultant there. So sort of before joining here, he used to be an ex-professor and head of the department of ENT in Sri Ramchandra Medical College from Chennai. He has been a postgraduate and undergraduate teacher. He has about more than 100 publications to his credit in international and national journals. He's a fellow of International College of Surgeons and has done a fellowship from the European Board. He has been trained exclusively in India as well as abroad in cochlear implant in the University of New York, in head and neck, in Sloan's Catering and the University of Massachusetts, and in neuro-otology in the University of Tübingen, Germany. He has been a prominent faculty in almost all national and international conferences. I invite him to have a talk, and he will be speaking today on surgical anatomy of thyroid and management of thyroid nodule. Sir, Dr. Sanjeev Mohanty.
Yeah. Thank you, Haritosh, for that elaborate introduction. But I, at the outset, let me let me put this across. Is it seen? I mean, the screen is seen.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So, yes, just a minute to introduce my thanks to the AOI flag bearers, I would say, and not the office bearers. So, Samir, it was very kind of you to have included me, and I'm humbled with the kind of association that we have. Bharti ma'am, and we have Yogesh, Haritosh, Ritu, and of course, my dear friend Prathamesh, with whom I've had wonderful interaction off and on the records, whether it's an official or unofficial format. So let's get to the topic straight away, the surgical anatomy. I mean, thyroid surgery is almost 350, 400 years old. But just to take you on to the actual history, the first thyroidectomy done was close to 400 years ago. And it was abandoned immediately because it was done on a 10-year-old child who died. And that was for a benign condition. So we've come a long way. And in the last 100 years, after Kocher started the concept of thyroid and its nuances, things haven't really changed other than the instrumentation and the concepts of approaching or trying to create some new vistas to get to the pathology. So the learning objectives of this talk would be, I'll try to be within this 45-minute slot that was given to me. Well, have a small introduction to this thyroid, a very concise literature review, and obviously the main core of today's talk is about surgical anatomy, which I think lot of people are in practice today are doing thyroids, we have the surgical endocrinologists, you have the general surgeons, you have head and neck oncologists, we have the surgical oncologists, we have ENT surgeons, and even today, these days, even the dental surgeons, you know, Max Fass are also putting their hands on thyroid. So it's everybody's game, and we need to know the anatomy. That's important. And why I made the fourth point, surgical landmarks as triangles, because there are a lot of postgraduates who probably would be here to be a part of today's show. And it's been everybody's nightmare to have multiple proper nouns associated with triangles peroperatively, and all of them revolve around certain important structures which I'm going to deal with. What does a surgeon need to know from their point of view? That is exactly the crux of the matter today. And we'll have the updates with the FNAC and USG criteria, with the ATA guidelines. We've come a long way from the British and the American Society, and how we have just taken into a particular format now. And obviously, the second part of the talk is the management of thyroid nodules, and few concluding remarks after that. So these are all the crux of exactly how I would plan my talk now. Obviously, no financial disclosures from any of the pharmaceutical companies or otherwise, and very few media files which have been taken from here and there. It's all our personal ones. Maybe some pictures from the textbooks and for better understanding. Okay. Now, it's anybody's guess that Kocher is called the father of thyroid surgery. Why? Not because he's got the Nobel Prize in 1909. That's about 111 years ago. But you have to understand that he was the one who started the incision, who started the first total thyroidectomy, which was done after he got the Nobel Prize, remember. And you can see what I've written there. The 18th century, the reported mortality was 40%. And based on that report, the French Society of Thyroid Surgery, endocrine surgeons networking with the general surgeons, who completely banned for the next 30, 40 years. So it was so bad because the antibiotic era was also not there. And there was a finesse with the investigations and the instrumentation. None of them were onto the mark. You can see the way it has been mentioned here. I'll just, 1 second. Yeah. You can see the sequence in which I've made this gentleman out here. The Kocher, Halstead, Kreil, Lahe, Beers, Berry, and Joel. The first few are from the United States. And that's what we keep telling. When you want to teach, we transfer the legacy. So Kocher led Halstead to know more about the nuances of thyroid surgery, followed by Kreil, and then he went to Lahe, and then Beers, and Berry and Joel in the UK started simultaneously somewhere else. So this is the brief introduction of how thyroid started. See, it's a huge topic, but we have to go to the important points for you all, or for us to understand a little better. I will just take this laser pointer, 1 second, yeah. Now, from a surgeon's perspective, what do we know about the thyroid gland? We need to respect anatomical landmarks. And the second point, these are the important areas that we look at: the recurrent nerve, the superior laryngeal nerve, and the parathyroids. The whole surgery revolves around these three most important things. And irrespective of whatever terminology and nomenclature that we use for thyroid, whether it is lobectomy, isthmusectomy, hemithyroidectomy, subtotal, near total, I think that's all been put to rest by the recent, it's not very recent, the guidelines. It's either hemi or total. You can play around with certain words, like extended hemi is including the isthmus, lobo-isthmusectomy, or total thyroidectomy. In between we do, I think we are in for some kind of a trouble later. So from the surgeon's point of view, we also require the FNAC grading. And I think even though the cytologist and the pathologist actually play a big role, we need to know a lot about this grading system. Then the thyroid scoring, many of them, in the exams, we keep asking, what is the full form of thyroid? So they fumble a little bit. But ultrasound, you know, it's fanciful for us to really think about CT, MRI and all that. But ultrasonography in thyroid is absolutely a must for us to, you know, plan any definitive treatment protocol with regards to thyroid pathology. Then radioactive iodine therapy post-operatively. Here there's a catch. Thyroid scintigraphy was in vogue earlier. In fact, yours truly has a paper on thyroid scintigraphy with technetium 99 also, because the half-life is very small. But off late, it has just been given away only in select conditions. You need to do that. And of course, the concept of molecular markers. I know there'll be a little bit of overlap between what I've already, I'm going to elucidate and what my colleague Prathamesh is going to talk on, because it's a very vast topic on differentiated carcinoma. So we'll have a lot to discuss in commonality. So that is how. So what do we look at? So the first thing that I told was the surgeon's perspective. Now, what do we look at the surgical landmarks? Sometimes if we miss out other than the ones that I told, we are in for trouble. So at each step, right from the incision. So if it's a too higher incision, it will look ugly. It will look a little ungainly. If you do it too lower, close to the, say, medial head on the clavicle or very close to the sternal notch, you will find the tendency of a little keloid formation. So you got to be very, very clear with the Langhans lines how to do it if you're doing a proper thyroidectomy. So we have landmarks. Everything is about landmarks. There's a superior inferior thyroid arteries. We know the superior is the first branch of the external carotid. Inferior thyroid artery is part of the thyrocervical trunk of the subclavian. So we know how they originate. And then we have the superior, middle, and inferior thyroid veins. There's another vein, which I'm coming to the next one, next topic, next slide. That will be the Kocher's vein, named after him. So that's between the middle and the inferior. The recurrent laryngeal nerve, as we know, the right and the left side, the right is little more angulated. So we have to take into account. So anatomy is extremely important, and no two patients will behave the same intraoperatively. So you have the left side, little more consistent. The right side is little more oblique. So we got to be very careful about that. And the external branch of superior laryngeal nerve, many of them, you know, think it's not important because you don't get to know it. You're just lucky that the patient has gotten away with it without exercising too much of a strain on the voice, but that is important. And of course, the parathyroid glands, the pyramidal lobe, the levator glandulae, this is sometimes present, which we need to have in mind. And another term that is tubercle of Zucker candle, which if present, which is probably more than 50% of the patients that we have seen. And in such cases, that is a good guide and marker for the rectal laryngeal nerve and, of course, the superior parathyroid. So in the same anatomical considerations, we have some important terms which we need to know. What is a true capsule? It's a condensation of the peripheral connective tissue. That's it. But suppose you are in the false capsule, you know you're only dealing with or dabbling with the pretracheal fascia. Gallen's anastomosis, just for a little academic interest, the ipsilateral recurrent laryngeal nerve with the internal branch of the superior laryngeal nerve, when they anastomose, that is the part of the sensation that gives inside the larynx. The non-recurrent laryngeal nerve, well, I haven't seen a single one till date, but in any study, in a meta-analysis, is less than 1.5 to 2% in the worldwide. So it is all due to some anomalous subclavian, mainly on the right side. I was talking to you about the Kocher's vein. The Kocher's vein is between the middle and the inferior. If it is present, you have to have in mind, if you suddenly find a vein between the middle and the inferior, you know it's Kocher's vein, and we have to be a little careful to go very close to the capsule and, you know, buzz it, because this, again, like the middle, drains directly into the inferior jugular vein. As we all know, that the inferior thyroid vein is again part of the innominate vein. I mean, it drains into the innominate. The variability of the parathyroid gland location is extremely important for us to understand. That is, more or less, the superior thyroid glands are generally in the same zone as we talk about the cricothyroid joint in and around near the superior pole. But the inferior parathyroid has a very variable course, which can go down right from the thymus up to the mediastinum. So you've got to be careful in that entire segment. And last point I wrote in red is because in spite of saving the parathyroid per se, if you do not save the vascularity, it is as good as not saving the gland. So you will have to have a firefighting post-operatively, even if you have seen the gland but not preserved the vascularity. And this is one of the journal which showed the surgeon's approach as early as 2000. It showed all details which I just elucidated. Continuing with the same anatomy. So the terms that I said, so Zucker candle, it is lateral posterior part of the thyroid lobe, and it's almost 60%. We cannot just neglect this. This is a very important marker. Although we say total thyroidectomy, sometimes we miss out this small area, and that could be a cause of concern. And it is also a marker for the recurrent laryngeal nerve that you see, and also it gives a guide even to the superior parathyroid on the right side. Usually it is present on the right side. Pyramidal lobe, as I told you, it's present in some cases, which we've encountered in a few. And another term, lateral aberrant thyroid. When you see a tissue which is not lymphatic, lateral to the carotid sheath, and you're wondering what is that, and it's not lymphatic, so it could be a lateral aberrant thyroid. Well, in such cases, you've got to rule out Mets for sure. Antereticular ligament, again, it's posterior to the isthmus, which is why it is important. It is vascular. So in the avascular plane, which I'm coming to in some time, that is different from the antereticular ligament. So you've got to be careful when you lift up, when you try the dissection, you can lift it up and take this as a marker for the antereticular ligament. And all of us know in the embryonical segment in the thyroglossal tract that you see the lingual thyroid is the most important that we all know, but it has all the other regions it can have, including the cardiac endothelium. So this is all about thyroid in a nutshell, about all the different general anatomy, which we can't go into the depth of all the microhistopathology and histology, but this is just to give you an overview. Now, what are the areas of risk? We've discussed so many things, but for the surgeon, if you are a little careful at the superior pole, you have all the structures there. Inferior pole, the structures there. The Berry's ligament before you lift up the thyroid and take off, and the cricothyroid joint. If we are careful at these zones when we operate, I think we'll do a safe thyroid surgery. And this is just to show the landmarks which are going to come in the subsequent slides I'm going to deal with in details. Just a mention of the tubercle of Zucker candle. If you are able to identify, you know the nerve is medial to it. And superiorly, or the cranial aspect, you'll find the superior thyroid, superior parathyroid gland, which is usually on the right side. The main important part is this, the third point. If it's hugely enlarged and you think you've done a total thyroidectomy, you might leave behind something. And leaving behind something in subtotal thyroidectomy is no more the rule now. Either you do hemi or a total thyroidectomy. So what I was talking about this. So this area, it's very close to the cricoid and the upper tracheal ring. So there's a chance that you might just miss it out, and that is a significant level of volume of tissue which can recur if it is prone for malignancy or any of those pathology. Now let's get to the actual stuff. Before going into the variations of cernias, I'm happy to note that in 2017, from Amrita Institute, they have done a correlation of cernias classification, which is phenomenal from an Indian standpoint, a good number of cases, and it is almost 78% of it matched with Sarnia's classification. So this is here to stay in spite of any of these. I've gone through a few meta-analysis done with the same classification, but believe me, these two are the ones which I found very, very close. And the second one in surgery today, this is a random survey of multi-centric trials, which they have done from Italy. You have Italy, China, Hong Kong, and Singapore, and in UK, all put together, a huge number of cases, close to some 800, 900 cases, and they found this is important. So basically what we are trying to say is two types of Sarnia's classification. The first, when you are safer, when the nerve is more than 1 centimeter beyond the upper pole. So you're happy. I mean, you don't even see, and that's all right for the beginners. Okay, we are safe. But if you're close to the gland, you've got to be the superior pole. You've got to be very, very careful. That is the 2A and 2B. More often than not, although people say that it is very easy to identify, it is not. Sometimes the nerve goes in between the branches. Sometimes the superior thyroid artery has multiple ramifications. You are not very sure. So got to be very careful. You need to dissect each part of it and go very close to the upper pole to see this is a 2B is the dangerous one. You think you have done it and you clamp the upper pole and you might have taken away the nerve. So this is Sarnia's classification from Brazil. Is here to stay. He's a wonderful gentleman. I mean, you interact with him. He's full of verb and energy and got a fantastic sense of humor too. Now, the next few slides will be completely on the triangles. This is mainly the elementary stuff, but it's important for the juniors in training and learning to understand all the triangles. And all these triangles are named after very established surgeons of repute. So Joel's triangle is a sternothyroid-laryngeal angle, which is basically you have the midline, upper pole, superior thyroid vessels. So in between only you'll have the nerve. So external branch, you need to know. It's very easy to just remember and try to mug up. But if you see a lot of cases, you know, if you keep the midline in view and you have the upper pole in hand, you will see the nerve and the artery coming. The vein and the artery, that is the superior pedicle. You will find the nerve medial to it. And because the floor is the cricothyroid, and that's what the nerve supplies. It is the external tensor of the vocal cord, which also gives that little bit of, you know, a pitch or timbre or quality to the voice. So it is extremely important for professional voice users, which is especially for singers. They will need that extra note. So we've got to be careful when you do that. So Joel's triangle. This triangle is related to the upper zone. Just remember, Joel's for the upper. Rest all triangles are for the recurrent angina nerve, which is O. Baer's triangle. It's also called a Riddle's triangle. Here we have three parts of the triangle, where the common carotid artery is one. The superior, this is the common carotid artery. This is the the trachea. So you'll have the inferior thyroid artery. This is the recurrent laryngeal nerve. So three parts form the Baer's triangle, and you can identify much better at a lower level. Lower level meaning it has to be from the tracheoesophageal groove. So if you are getting the whole dissection from below upwards, you will find this triangle very, very important, and it is quite nice to identify it. You generally will not go wrong. So different names are there. One is Baer's. Next, the Simon's triangle, the same thing, but here the base is different. You have the common carotid and you have the anteriorly the recurrent laryngeal nerve. If you go back to the Baer's, it's the same thing, but here you have the inferior thyroid artery as one of the sides of the triangle, but in Simon's, you'll have the cricothyroid muscle as the base. This also gives us a good idea about the parathyroid glands and its supply. Just a small point about the parathyroids also. Although we keep saying, the superior parathyroids are very stable in the same position and all that, all the four parathyroids, sometimes the fifth one, are majorly supplied by the inferior thyroid artery. Close to 80%. Very rarely you'll have a few from superior thyroid. And 80, the rule of 80, 80% of the time, it's a single artery which is supplying the, a branch from the inferior thyroid supplying the parathyroid gland. So in the rest 20%, probably a few multiple branches would be there from both the sides. So got to be very careful. Each small twig is important to devascularize. So you've got to be careful about that. Again, there's another triangle called Lowry's triangle. This is the retrolaryngeal node triangle, which, again, common carotid. Common carotid is a very important one. For beginners, if they are struggling to really find out where the nerve is as the part of the triangle, the best thing is medially, you know it's a trachea and the esophagus. Laterally, common carotid is easy with the carotid sheath. Superiorly, if you retract the undersurface of the lower pole, you will find the nerve there. And that is, again, on the lower part, that is the Lowry's triangle. So if you look at, just to summarize, Joel's triangle is for the superior thyroid. The Beard's triangle and the Simon will have the common carotid and the recurrent laryngeal nerve as common arms of the triangle. The only difference is in Beard's, you will have the inferior thyroid artery superiorly. That's the landmark. That is important. And beyond that, you have the cricothyroid muscle. Lowry's triangle, you don't know anything. Just you know the trachea esophagus. On one side, you have the common carotid, and you will have the superiorly. Obviously, the low pole will be there superiorly. So in that area, got to dabble very, very meticulously, you will find out. Now, how to identify the inferior thyroid artery? That's important. See, all look alike in the red thing, you know. So you'll have the superior thyroid vein, the middle thyroid vein, the Kocher's vein, the inferior thyroid artery, and all that. Just when you expose the carotid sheath, any artery which is coming behind the carotid sheath, that is the inferior thyroid artery. I mean, I'm trying to make it hopefully simple for the juniors. Seniors must be having their own tricks how to get to it. But this is the way we can learn and make no mistake about it. There's something called triangle of concern. Triangle of concern is nothing. At the root of the neck, you have all the veins and arteries and all of them going into the mediastinum. So you've got to be careful in those areas when you dissect. This is especially important when you are dealing with a very low plunging thyroid, maybe with a retrosternal extension, or for that matter, if you have something else, some malignancy with a neck dissection and all that. I didn't talk about the space of Reeves. This is the most safest zone if you are going into it. This is the cricothyroid space where there isn't any vasculature, very minimal. You go there and you can easily identify the area where you can dissect across the strap muscles. And then once you lift it up, you will find access to the superior pole with all its vascular pedicle. So just to summarize in a nutshell regarding the anatomy of the thyroid, as a surgeon's point of view, would be both the nerves. There are four veins, a couple of arteries, and the parathyroid glands. The variability has to be in mind when you look at, when you go in the dissection mode. So every part of it should progress in a series of very logical, orderly, anatomically stable base steps. So if you go into that, obviously, you should not go wrong. And that will give rise to a very safe surgery with a capsular dissection. Yes. Now getting to the second part of the talk. Hopefully, I'm good on time. Still a lot of time left. But this is about thyroid nodules. So having known the different nuances of anatomy, especially gross, now we get to the nodules. I'm sure it will be dealt with in extra detail by Padmesh Bhatta. I just want to tell you, if there is a single nodule, multiple nodules, everything has a different connotation. Benign, it could be cyst. Outside, you don't know whether it's a cyst or it's a solid organ inside or it's a inflammatory region or it's a mets. You have no idea about it. So in such cases, the spectrum, malignant, I'm not going to touch. That is somebody else's domain. But today, just for completion, any nodule could be benign or malignant. So in such cases, what we have seen, more than 90% are benign. And it's often reported wrongly and erroneously. Let me tell you, in the last 2 years, I've seen more of malignant than benign. It's maybe it is just a conjectural coincidence. I'm not very sure. But earlier, it used to be at least 6 out of 10 nodules that I was seeing was definitely benign. And it's just reversed now. 6 out of 10 are malignant, at least in my practice. Now, what do you do with non-palpable thyroid nodules? It's an epidemic, they say. And they say in UK and US, it is close to 40 to 50%. I mean, asymptomatic, non-palpable, those 1 centimeters or 1.5 centimeters kind of thing, which are incidental omas. When you just check it with an ultrasound, you find, okay, there is something, but patient is totally not wary of or aware of, and they have the TSH normal, thyroid function, all good. Just to tell you, these are the ones which has prompted the molecular scientist to probe further. And in such cases, you will find more in females and then in males. But roughly around 5 to 6% of them would be having non-palpable nanodules. Now let's get to the diagnostics. What do? You find a nodule. It could be whatever age group. Obviously, we'll go for a thyroid function test. We'll do T3, T4, TSH. And I've highlighted the important ones because those are the ones that is probably the standard of care these days. And that is the FNAC. The radiology would revolve around ultrasound. There's a tendency for any malignancy or suspected malignancy, okay, get a PET scan and come. But PET has a very difficult, different indication in thyroid malignancies or thyroid pathology. Only if you have indeterminate nodules, maybe you can think of, and you've got to categorize the prognostication of risk category in distant mets if you're thinking. And obviously, thyroid scintigraphy is not the first choice. Only in certain cases, not in a toxic nodule, probably you can. In hyperthyroid state, you can, just to rule out. And here, we know if the tracer take-up is a very irrelevant or very inadequate, they are called cold nodules. And if it is taking more than what the adequate amount, that is hot nodules, I mean, especially hyperthyroid and all that. And in cold nodules, you've got to rule out malignancy. And I've written this 20% is just straight from the textbook. But believe me, again, this was a study conducted by me and my team in the last 5 years back. And I got a result of 46% over, of course, the numbers, the N isn't 304 and N was only 62. But yet, in 62 cases, we had 46% cold nodules actually turning out to be malignant. So any cold nodule, deal with us, with a lot of precision for the diagnostics. Now coming to the most important part, FNAC these days, you see yield is bad, this and that. Here, this is here to stay, no question about it. If there is a Bethesda 1, just leave it. If it is Bethesda 2, it's benign. Again, until and unless there is a real indication, we need not put the scalpel. It's only between 3, 4, and 5 that we have to be extremely careful. 6 is a given. I mean, we have to do total thyroidectomy. So the ATP of undetermined significance, that is OS, AUS, or follicular leoplasm, FN, or of undetermined significance, or SMC, they say, all these three, the first three, 3, 4, 5 in Bethesda is important for surgeons. And we have to, not surgeons exactly, the doctors or the caregivers to really get into it. So you can see the difference. Bethesda 1, 2, and you see the difference between the 3, 4, and 5. 3, 4, 5 are the gray zones. These are definitely not shades of gray. We are really in trouble because we don't know what to do next. So we have to follow up regularly and keep categorizing them with each visit to the doctor. And for adequacy in FNAC, we need at least 6 groups and at least 10 cells in a single slide. That is called adequacy. If you don't do this, probably the diagnosis might be a little erroneous with passage of time and giving us a lot of headaches. So what are the ultrasound features? Next, getting to the ultrasound, the FNAC is over. So anything, any cyst or any of the nodules less than 1 centimeter with comet tail sign, very, very important for benign disease. So just leave it and it is wait and watch till we see any symptoms of pressure or probably ungainly site for them to really warrant a surgery. Features of malignancy, I'll just briefly touch because it's going to be told in detail. So any calcification, hypoechoogenicity, absence of halo, and tall cells than wide, irregularity of the nodule, and increased blood flow are the signs of malignancy, which is straight away Bethesda 6, and it will correlate with thyroid 6. This is something which I told you, you can go there. I'll spend about a few minutes here. Now, thyroid nodule imaging reporting and data system is here to stay. The first one from Dutch, they did some ultrasonography. Then there's a British group, then the European group. But this is ACR, American College of Radiology. I think this slide is important because there are hundreds of literature to really substantiate all the thyroid's rating. But for a surgeon, we need to know the composition. I mean, all of this. Just remember the scoring. Any of these three, any of these five, if they score 3, we are really entering a no man's land and we've got to be very careful. You see in echogenicity, if it is very hypoechoic, it's 3 points already. So if it's echogenic 3 and rest others are normal, still it comes in AUS. That is the third category. Now, if you look at, for example, microcalcification, only 1 point. And here, tall and wide is 3 points. That's enough. 4 points, straight away thyroid's 4. Again, it is of follicular neoplasm of suspected malignancy. So any markings here, any numbers that is written here, which if you score beyond 3, whether the radiologist has been able to interpret or you've been with them to talk your way through, you have to give these patients a very patient hearing and good purposeful follow-up over a period of time. Now, this is exactly what I said. The first thyroid, straight away, no risk of malignancy. 2, no risk. 3, probably benign, but then there's still 5% chances there. Got to be careful. Now, the 4 and 5 are the ones who require a very good follow-up with molecular markers. 5, very, very suggestive. It's more than 80%. So 5 and 6, at least in my center, because sometimes we get a lot of referral patients, so we do a total thyroidectomy, frozen and proceed kind of thing. But these two, we wait and see how they do after a good diagnostic workup. So I repeat again, thyroids 1 to 3, no problem. It's thyroids 4 and 5, again, a gray zone, and 6 is a given. Now, how do we initially evaluate? A patient comes to you. What do we do? We do all the routine steps, as I told you, but only if you get a normal or a high TSH, probably it's a good idea to do a scintigraphy and find out whether cold or hot nodule. And if it is nodule is there, FNA is a standard of care, irrespective of whatever the literature says. In today's world, whether you want to do a direct ultrasound guided or a direct FNAC, FNA is a standard of care. Cytology is important. However, it has its own demerits. It will not be able to classify the atypia of unknown significance, that is OS, and the follicular neoplasm. So those 3, 4, and 5 Bethesda are important for us to go further in the diagnostic tree. This is something which I think he will talk, but I'll just briefly get into it. The reason why I put this slide is, when you have atypia of unknown significance or follicular neoplasm of unknown significance or follicular neoplasm or suspected malignancy, the thyroid mutation panel, which is, I think, established now, BRAF, RAS, RET-PTC, and PAX8, these are all very, very established. This is a subsequent to the earlier markers, the epidermal growth factor or the fibroblast growth factor, FGP and all that. that is now taken a backseat. These panels are very, very important. And you can see the sensitivity straight away. If it's positive, you know the cancer risk is 95. So, and here, only with Bethesda cytology, you can have the risk is only 30%, but here it becomes 95%. So the 3, 4, and 5 I was talking about, if they are within that range of, say, 20-30%, the molecular markers will give us a good sense of relief. If it is positive, we are looking at a probably imminent malignancy. It's better to do a total thyroidectomy. If not, we have to hold on and just do lobectomy and keep proceeding. And this is a patient-related with ATA guidelines, completely tells us that you have to discuss with the patient, telling the pros and cons, and continuing forward with what definitive treatment plan that you have for the patient. It's all about attitude communication, which is already part of the curriculum in MBBS these days. The rational approach, similar thing. Any cold nodule, straight away, you know it is unproven malignancy. Again, the scintigraphy with FNAC as well as the ultrasonography, all together amalgamate to give us a good direction as to what we should do for these patients. And if it is, of course, I'm sure we'll have more details about the size and all that. So some say less than 2 centimeter. It's again a gray zone with everything else is normal. And molecular markers show some positivity for BRAF. Then we don't know what to do. Again, follow up. So like that. This is just to tell you intraoperative view, which we just discussed, again, to jog back our memory just about 20 minutes back. This is the Simon's triangle. And if you look at, can see this. This is the trachea. This is the groove. You have the recurrent nerve there, the infrathyroid artery, common carotid. So if you're talking about Lorius triangle, you can look at this as a trachea and esophagus here, the common carotid, and in between, you will definitely get this. And this is the retracted lower pole. So this zone is extremely important. And the superior level of this dissection when you do or dabble around this area is inferior thyroid artery. So idea is first identify the inferior thyroid artery, whether it's a nodule, hemithyroidectomy, total thyroidectomy, neck dissection, anything. You need to get that landmark perfectly in your view. And then once you know the upper limit, you have the medial limit as the trachea and the esophagus. The lateral is the carotid sheath. And as you can see, it is behind the carotid sheath, the infrathyroid artery coming here. And just to show this as a tubercle of Zucker candle, this is the zone. So again, you see the trachea, you have the recurrent dungeon nerve. And this is the zone of Zucker candle, very closely attached. It's a posterior extension of the lobe and it's attached to the thyroid. And here is the superior thyroid. You see exactly. So here we have the superior parathyroid, the Zucker candle, and this is the homing point of the recurrent dungeon nerve at the cricothyroid joint. So basic idea to tell you this is something which it names sound very fancy. And the spelling also doesn't have an E at the end. It's only Zucker candle, but it is important. And it is, at least in my practice, I would say close to 50-60% of the time, we definitely find this. And that is we call it the homing point of the rectal angina, very, very stable landmark. And I think one should adopt means to do that. So the take-home message would be, to exclude thyroid cancers in thyroid nodules, even if it's single or multiple, and which really goes up to close to 7 to 15% of all patients of thyroid nodules. It is taken from literature, but ground reality is much more. If you are in a tertiary care center and you get a lot of referrals, this 15% can go up to 40%. Non-palpable nodules, this is important, will have the same risk of malignancy as ultrasound-guided, confirmed palpable nodules. So it is not that if you don't palpate, they are safe. No. If USG finds out a small nodule, which is, say, 2 centimeters and or less than that, and you have the same risk for the same patient if you are not able to palpate. Serum TSH. Yes, it's again a guideline by the American Society. which they say it's better to have TSH levels rather than thyroglobulin or calcitonin, thinking in terms of medullary carcinoma and other problems. See, these ATA guidelines, what are they? They set standards. They give us a time to audit and create good patient outcomes if we follow these principles. That's why the task force had not only ENT surgeons, they had surgical endocrinologists, they had the community medicine people, they had pathologists, oncopathologists, thyroid surgeons, a lot of them together, and they mulled all the decision over a period of time. They took a lot of time. From 2015, they went on, and recently they had the new criteria with the 45 became 55. The rest of it, Patmesh will say. It goes without saying a good surveillance protocol is required for patients of those three zones that I said, 3, 4, and 5. That is nodules with undetermined significance is the one which is a bugbear for all of us, and we need to be very clear on that. So this is the take-home message. My remarks would be still in the small presentation that I had to share. The FNAC is the treatment, is the investigation of choice, wherein we would definitely want to know more about the pathology happening within. Even though we respect the ultrasound, FNAC will be important. It cannot be seen in isolation, ultrasound. And most of the nodules with non-diagnostic cytology usually will be benign. And this is close to 70-80%. And in pregnancy, sometimes due to the effect of hypothyroidism, there's a challenge to the TSH and the pituitary. Sometimes the enlargement of nodules happen. But if it's not very significant, we need not bother much for those women in confinement. Molecular testing as an adjunct, well, the BRAF, PET, CT, all of that, you're going to talk. It is definitely helping us in prognostication and risk stratification for patients who are already diagnosed with those ATPI and follicular neoplasms. We need to follow them up very, very succinctly. Bethesda grading, thyroids here to stay, and they are sine qua non, which is a part of the diagnostic protocol. And the spectrum of investigation will definitely help us to reach a good patient outcome post-treatment. I won't say post-operatively. Nothing to miss out on the respect to the neurovascular anatomy. I've not written the parathyroid because these two, if you respect, automatically the parathyroid will be saved. And that is the key to safe thyroid surgery. So just to wind up, let me have my acknowledgement for MGM Healthcare for providing the innumerable number of patients that we have been operating over the last year and a half. And of course, not to forget a massive 20 years in SRMC, where they have given entire thing, right from the training, learning, infrastructure, teaching, you know, had a lot of them. And that is what has given us this idea of protocols. And we follow it with the right earnest to get to all of a good patient outcome post-treatment. And that's on the rest of it. I had my all there. Thank you very much for a patient hearing. Hopefully, I can't see the crowd just like the IPL matches. You have only the background noise. So I think I'm on time. And rest is up to the panel out here to understand and see how I can contribute. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Mohanty, for your excellent talk. Now, we had invited some questions. And there are certain questions which have come up. So the if you can take it, I will go through it. Yeah.
If I can't answer, I'll send it to Prathamesh, so no problem.
Dr. Anita Kothari from Jaipur.
Yep.
She is asking whether a 14-year-old girl with a single thyroid nodule for at least 2 to 3 years with a T3, T4, TSH normal, would you operate or would you not?
Definitely not. Normal T3, T4, TSH, even T3, T4, even if you take it away, if the TSH is normal, but the size is growing, I would definitely do, if it's a very prominent nodule, I'll first do an ultrasound and see how non-invasive and how good it is. probably take a FNAC, and I'm sure it will be benign only at that time. And so below 20, it is an important risk factor for sure. Below 20 and above 40, 55 is a risk in today's world. I would subject these patients, if you said it's a normal TSH. If it's a normal TSH, I would still follow up and see the trend, whether the size is increasing in the nodule size is increasing, or there's a suppression of TSH. If it is getting suppressed, then I will think of a thyroid scintigraphy. And I would not hesitate to go for a technetium 99-1 for this particular patient, young child, 14-year-old, with a low half-life. I think it's not a bad idea to subject them for a lesser radiation also. I hope that answers.
Thank you. The next question is from Dr. Prakash Munka.
Yes.
From Bhopal Steel.
Yeah, thank you, sir.
City. Yeah. He is asking, is thyroid's grading almost similar akin to COAD's grading of HRCT lung?
I'm not a pulmonologist, but to get to that, it's difficult for me to answer that question for the lung COAD's. Yeah, basically he was making a comment, you know, the thyroid 6. So basically the thyroid 6, the gradings came from BI-RADS, from the breast cancer. So from BI-RADS came to thyroids, and probably that's the reason why the COAD's has come again from the Dutch, maybe. It's a Dutch criteria.
Dr. Ashish Varghese from Ludhiana,
yes.
He asked whether in a thyroglossal cyst, is there any indication for isotopes?
Yes, very much. In fact, in my series, I've got three malignancies, papillary cyst adenocarcinoma of 8-year-old, 10-year-olds. And that obviously it helps. Yes, Dr. Ashish, that is a very, very important point. See, this was a talk, I had to concise it to the needs of the topic. So that's why I didn't go into the details of all the embryological remnants too much. But yes, thyroglossal cyst, or rather thyroglossal duct anomalies, if it is showing the only thyroid bed is empty and you have only the lingual or in that area, subhyoid or wherever, we need a scan for sure. Of course, it's anybody's choice whether to get a iodine scan or a radio or a technetium 99. Depends.
Yeah. One more question. Your first investigation for any thyroid nodule, how would you proceed?
I would.
When you were a patient.
First thing to get to them and get the confidence, first T3, T4, TSH, number one. Yeah. They come back. I will tell them, please get an ultrasound done. So, you know, that will give us a very good idea about what we are looking at. The moment I get a call from the radiologist, you know, this thyroid 4 or something like that, immediately I said, the same setting, if you can do an ultrasound guided, it will be nice. The cytologist, same time, we need to, you know, check with the pathologist to really see whether sometimes they say the inadequate sample and all that. So we need to know exactly. As I told you, 6 follicular cells have to be there in a single slide. Then only we can think of an adequacy to get to a diagnosis. See, both are they're complementary to each other. We need the FNAC as well as this. Just by ultrasound, we can't really say that it is probably tall cells. You know, to my eyes, tall could be correct. But for radiologist eyes, maybe you will see something different and the white might be taller, bigger than the tall. So we have to be very careful, and the grading completely changes.
Right. Dr. Bhavna Rai from Gangtok.
Okay.
A little out of topic, she says, sir, how to manage a recurrent thyroiditis?
Okay. No, not out of topic. I mean, obviously, this inflammatory thyroid. So, inflammatory thyroid, if it is, again, a little lower in TSH, again, the same thing. Very, very, it's mathematical. Any inflammatory thyroid, we need to know whether it's autonomic or inflammatory, or if it's subacute or acute, or it's a generalized one. So if it is low TSH, we know there's a hyperactivity. When the hyperactivity is happening, so obviously we need to go for a scan again, you know, and then find out. how to deal with it. Probably steroids is the right way forward, and then take it forward with the seeing. Thyroiditis, what I understand from the question, it's more of a generalized inflammatory reaction for the thyroid, diffuse rather than a nodule. I think that's what she meant. So probably painkillers and this about it. I did not talk about the thyroid peroxidase antibodies and all that. That probably it's not the purview of this talk. So there's a lot of things to, you can talk a lot on thyroid, but you have to make it very simple.
Dr. Sanchi Rai from Gangtok again. What will be the thyroid function status in most of the cases of thyroid malignancy? Does it help in any way in interpretation of the diagnosis of malignancy?
Yeah, increased TSH trend is not a good marker. We need to be careful about it. Definitely, we need to be careful with the period of time. A serial markers, the ideal marker would be thyroglobulin, along with obviously calcium, and we will have serial scans. But just by TSH levels to see what it was earlier and then how it is growing up, it will also give you the idea of how much to titrate the dosage of the thyroid supplementation also. So that is important. So it will give an idea.
Dr. Shyama from Kannur. She has two questions. She is asking you, how will you follow up a case of benign nodule in your office? How often and when would you follow up and try to see?
See, benign, depending on, first of all, and again, it's a very personal question, so I'm going to answer what I do. So if it's on the right side, I will get the follow-up a little earlier. And this is just a kind of an observation that I've had. The right-sided nodule, it tends to become a little more quicker growing in size than the left side. So that's the reason I would have a little closer follow-up for such patients. And anyway, the benchmark is the first one will be an ultrasound. And FNAC, obviously, it is after that only we can say it's benign. So if it's benign, I'll just wait and watch and keep following up. Because keeping the patient in that. Till they have, hopefully, not any pressure symptoms or change of voice or any of those.
Next question is, if patient with Bethesda 2 on USG,
okay,
but having pain over the swelling and symptoms of tiredness and all sorts of thyroid symptoms, how will you manage?
No, in such cases, again, the treatment would be completely monitored by the way that we look at the thyroid supplementation level. If it's only two, there is no way to do anything. You know, just wait and watch, and this tiredness can go off with some nutritious diet. And pain, obviously, we can give all those. We see a lot of these patients nowadays, vague symptoms. So similarly, for thyroid, maybe we'll have to look at some nutritional part and then carry on further.
Can I ask one question?
Yes.
Yeah. Most of the thyroid nodules, basically what you will be operating. Any protocol regarding where and how to start the surgery, whether at the superior pole, inferior pole, or any you have in mind?
Yeah, very nice question, because sometimes if it's, I'll tell you, if it is not thought to be malignant and we just do it as a protocol for, say, for example, frozen and proceed. So frozen is just given and we have started to close. Those sort of cases, that means, thyroid 3 or something like that, and it's nicely come out, then I would first, definitely, I would go for the lower pole. And then if it is a malignant, say thyroid 6, if it's a real problematic case, just to buy little time, I go to the space of Reeves, first ligate the upper pole, and I'm sure that one thing is already off. Now slowly concentrate on the low pole, like that. It's not very, exactly how to, depends on the cases And on the right side, I'll be doubly careful. Of course, both sides you have to be extremely careful, but right side, because of the general anatomy, slight deviation from the normal, that the recurrent angular nerve is slightly superficial, slightly lateral, angulated, we have to be very sure of this. And remember one thing, the infrathyroid artery, when it gives branches to the parathyroid, that zone is very, very risky zone. You have to be extremely careful. Of course, there are proponents of microscopic thyroid. I just don't do that, but I use a loop. So that helps me quite a bit to understand the intricate branches, branching patterns which happen, especially in the recurrent angular nerve, before it has gotten to the homing point of the larynx. It gives two branches. I have seen that many a time. And each branch, one goes to the abductor and one goes to the adductor of the larynx. So that cricothyroid joint is extremely important. You can figure that out.
Thank you, Dr. Sanjeev.
Yep.
The questions are still coming. Can we take it at
yeah,
the later?
Yeah, then. Yeah, yeah.
Some way, can?
Yes. I'm looking forward
Yogesh,
to...
Yeah. So most of whatever questions I have asked, and they're still coming. So how do we go about Dr. Yogesh?
Yeah, we can take some questions at the end also.
Yep.
Not a problem.
Okay.
So we can... because sir will be logged in also. So
I'm eager to listen to my friend anyway.
So you want to ask any question now, you can ask Dr. Aritosh.
No, there's one more question which has come. What would you be more specific about, whether the USG report or the cytology?
This is a very tricky question, because I would want both, very, very sure. And I'll tell you, I have rubbished quite a few reports which is done with patients coming with some vague report. There is microcalcification. I need the scoring. You know, that's how we have trained a radiologist who's, there is a specific radiologist who's only doing, a very good work with ultrasound of the thyroid with the markings and the scoring, which I just showed that slide. That is extremely important. But cytology, obviously, you need that tissue diagnosis. So cytology, and sometimes if it's required, FNAB also, if you're really having a little dilemma, yes, with some pressure symptoms, and suppose it shows a very low category of thyroid, obviously, we need a little more intervention. So both, there's nothing one at all. It has to be both.
Thank you, Dr. Sanjeev.
Yeah, thanks a lot. Thanks,
Dr. Yogesh will take over from you.
Thank you, Dr. Mohanty, for a very informative session. Thank you, Dr. Haritosh.
Thank you, Hari. Thank you, Yogesh.
I welcome our next moderator for the day, Dr. Ritu Sheth. She is the president of AOI Mumbai, and she is an honorary consultant in AGB ENT Hospital. Welcome, Dr. Ritu. Over to you.
Yeah. Thank you, Yogesh. I would like to welcome Dr. Prathamesh Pai to give his lecture. Dr. Pai is a professor and a consultant, a chief of unit at Department of Head and Neck Oncology at Tata Memorial Hospital, Mumbai. He has been a conveyor of the Skull-Based Clinic. He is a UICC fellow. He got it in 2002. And he has been got the Hargobind Fellowship to University of Pittsburgh, USA. He has been a former convener of the Head and Neck Disease Management Group at Tata Memorial Hospital. He was a former secretary of the Foundation of Head and Neck Oncology and the founding secretary of Indian Society of Thyroid Surgeons. His special interests are endoscopic and open skull-based surgery, conservative laryngeal surgery, and transoral laser surgery. I welcome Dr. Prathamesh, who has been my senior and mentor for the past 20 years, to give his talk on thyroid.
Thank you, Ritu. And at the outset, I'd like to thank all the members of AOI leadership who have started this very fantastic program, which has kept everybody occupied in the COVID times and also improved our knowledge. And I think it's very important to realize that continued medical education is what is going to keep our field at the top of its position. So without much ado, I will like to start my presentation. What my job today was to speak on What are the current management strategies in the management of thyroid cancers? One moment. Okay. So when we are looking at thyroid cancers, we are dealing basically with thyroid nodules. And Sanjeev actually spoke at length and beautifully on how you're going to diagnose it and consider the various factors in evaluation. Now, when we're looking at these thyroid cancers, what strikes us is that there are some which are obviously malignant and there are some that may be benign. And we need to realize that malignancies are rare in the population. So we know that all these go towards having a risk factor for malignancies. But really, when you go through all these, you realize that most of our patients will not be having these risk factors. So how do you really explain this fact that there has been almost a threefold rise in thyroid cancers in the past 30 years? But what we need to also realize is that the deaths from thyroid cancers has remained the same. That means though we will see more of thyroid cancers, they will be less virulent and we will be able to treat them better. Now, there has been a changing trend in the incidence and the type of cancer that we are seeing. And what we used to see 20, 30 years ago were the high risk cancers, which were possibly caused by iodine deficiency, and they were aggressive lesions. And now what we are managing and what we will be seeing in future will be the low risk patient. It is very important to realize that there is an increased incidence, but there's a reduced incidence also of all these virulent cancers over the past two decades. Our own center, you can see that most of our patients will now come with papillary thyroid cancers. Less and less we are seeing the follicular cancers and the other variants are extremely low. So what has caused this change in thyroid cancers? Possibly it could be the change in diet. There's now an increased iodine content in most of our foods. It also could be the extensive use of ultrasound in neck masses. We are seeing patients coming to us with incidentally picked up lesions. Also, we have more pathologists who can diagnose it. And hence, these all could be the cause that we are actually seeing a large number of cancers. Having said all that, there is a lot of problem in the management of these cancers across the country and the globe. Improper diagnosis, improperly performed procedures, non-standardized names given to procedures, and incomplete documentation. And all these CMEs should help solve these problems over time. What we need to understand in thyroid cancers, the bare minimum, is that we should avoid multiple procedures for our patient. We should reduce the morbidity which comes through a redo surgery. We need to reduce the failure of treatment. And believe me, this being a very curable cancer, we want to avoid failure. And we need to improve the overall survival. Now, this is a common occurrence of 18-year-old female who presents to you with a paramedian neck swelling. Often our dilemma is how do you investigate and are you really suspecting a malignancy in this patient? The large lesions, which are more than 4 centimeters, extremes of age, as Sanjeev mentioned, the male gender, recent onset rapid growth, and prior history of radiation and other high risk features like previous treatments. These are your should raise your antenna for possibility of a malignancy. And remember, an early diagnosis will lead to an excellent prognosis. So how you do the workup of these patients? Sanjeev actually alluded to them very elegantly. What we need to realize is thyroid scan is not to be done unless you have your TSH being low and you're suspecting a thyroiditis. Most of your treatment should start with an ultrasound. And today you should do an ultrasound guided FNAC and not an FNAC on your own. Now, when it comes to ultrasound, you need to understand what is mandatory. What are the kind of probes that you'll use? And whether you'll actually look at your report in a checklist fashion. Now, what should your thyroid ultrasound tell you? And this is what you all need to look at and discuss with your radiologist. Is there a nodule? What is the size of the nodule? Are there any benign or suspicious features? Where is it in the location in the thyroid gland? Are there any cervical lymph nodes in the central compartment, lateral compartment? And one important feature is they can actually just tell you whether the subclavian is absent or not. An abnormal subclavian should highlight to you during surgery on the right side, you would have a non-recurrent nodule. And this is very simple for the radiologist to tell you. So these are all the ultrasound characteristics Sanjeev has already discussed. But what we need to understand is that the risk stratification of malignancy is dependent on a very good ultrasound. When you increase the possibility of having microcalcification, vascularity, loss of halo, taller lesions and wider, those are the ones that are looking as malignant tumors. Now, most of the ultrasound machines today have this feature called the elastography, and you need to be aware because you need to ask your radiologist to tell you. Elastography is nothing but tells you the elastic property and the stiffness of the soft tissue by pressing it. So with this, it is now able to give us a color coding. So the dark blue means it is a soft lesion, more likely to be benign. And the red, when it's dark red, it is a very densely packed material, which is more likely to be a malignant tumor. We know from literature and meta-analysis that the sensitivity using the elasticity score improves your yield. So you know that you can be more sure that whether or not this is a malignancy. Ultrasound is your key to diagnosis today. And we know from this meta-analysis that if your ultrasound has features such as microcalcification, irregular margins, and is taller than wider, the possibility that it is having a malignancy is to the tune of 3 times more than a lesion which doesn't have this. Absence of elasticity, again, increases your sensitivity with a yield of almost 6 times. So if the patient has an absence of elasticity, it is more likely to be malignant. And the vascularization, presence of a central vascularization increases the possibility again twofold. So at the Tata Hospital, we came out with another scoring in 2017. Wherein we use elasticity along with the other prognostic features which we just went through. So elastography score and the prognostic features of the size and microcalcification, etc. And negative features such as purely cystic, spongiform, or comet tail artifacts, which suggest that it is a benign lesion. So when you have a combination of two or more features of these, you have a final score which has positive predictors minus the negative predictors. So this was a very simple method of utilizing all the information that you would get, the margins, the shape, echogenicity, the composition, calcifications, vascularity, elastography, lymph node status, and benign. So when you see the TMC-RSS score had all these together, and then when you compare them to the TIRADS and the ACR TIRADS, you could easily differentiate them into a low risk, an intermediate risk, and a high risk. So you know that a low and intermediate risk have less than 18% possibility of it being a malignancy, whereas the high group, TMC-RSS score will tell you that this is more than 6, will tell you that it is a malignant lesion. Please see that your radiologist reports it in a very standardized fashion. Our radiologists use a simple tool such as this, labeling the right and the left lobe, and all those features are labeled. So you know that you will not miss a single feature when you're reporting. And this is what leads to a better report and a standardization of reporting. Now, should we FNAC all the nodules? Now, we know that ultrasound-guided FNAC is standard of care. You should not today poke a needle on your own because you really do not know whether it's a cystic, a solid, or a mixed lesion. And if it is a mixed lesion, you would actually need to target the solid component. Now, why is it important? Because when you have a high suspicion nodule, so when your radiologist tells you that it is having all these features which are high risk and the lesion is more than a centimeter, you should do a FNAC. On the other hand, if you have an intermediate risk and you have got a lesion which is more than a centimeter, you should do an FNAC. So the bottom line is that if there is a solitary thyroid nodule more than a centimeter, and if you have a malignant goiter with altered antibodies, remember in malignancies, you have a more than, with thyroiditis, you have a 25% chance of malignancy. Please do not do a FNAC if your nodule is less than 5 millimeters, is cystic, and there are non-suspicious nodules. This is the new Bethesda system classification come out in 2017. And again, standardization. You need to ask your pathologist to report according to this classification. What is different from the earlier Bethesda is the possibility of a NIFP. And with the weightage given to the NIFP, your risk of malignancy has been altered in the new Bethesda. It has not changed too much, but it improves the yield of a malignancy when you report according to this. For those who are residents and training, you need to understand what is this NIFP. It is a non-invasive follicular thumb with papillary. Earlier, we used to call this an encapsulated follicular variant papillary thyroid cancer. But we need to understand that this may not be a cancer at all. And as it is non-invasive, it is contained well with the tumor capsule, and it has extremely low risk of adverse outcomes. So there are certain criteria which the pathologist will follow and then label it as a NIFP. So even if your lesion is 4 centimeters and more, and it is labeled as a NIFP, you need to realize that you might be able to do less for your patient and avoid all kinds of adjuvant therapy. It is very important to call this as a tumor rather than a carcinoma, because you know that these patients may not really fit into the classification of a cancer. Now, what is the implication of Bethesda scoring? If you have a Bethesda 3 and 4, that is where the dilemma occurs. If you have a Bethesda 3, it is more likely that you should repeat it after a period of 3 to 6 months. If it is, however, Bethesda 4 and above, you should advise your patient surgery. Now, your patient is in front of you. Ultrasound shows a 1.5 by 1.5 lesions, wider than taller, no microcalcification, and increased central vascularity. So mix of both features. An FNAC done shows a Bethesda 3, which is a follicular lesion of undetermined significance. Now the dilemma is, how will you manage it? Would you repeat it like I advise, or would you do a genetic testing? Sanjeev pointed out what the whole array of genetic markers which are now being used. So you need to understand molecular markers are here to stay. They have a role not only in diagnosis, but also in prognosis. All these are the ones that are being used and have been found to be very significant in their ability to diagnose. So what are the common genetic alterations? In papillary carcinomas, you have got the BRAF and the RAS genes, and you have the red PTC rearrangements. And almost 70% of papillary carcinomas will have some of these rearrangements. Follicular carcinomas, you have the RAS mutations, and we have the PAX8 and the PPARG rearrangement. And of course, in the medullary thyroid cancers, you have the red point mutations. You can understand that if you use this and you were able to diagnose a flus with the galactin-3, in literature, you know, almost 70% you could avoid doing a thyroid surgery. In BRAF, if you have a BRAF mutation seen on immunohistochemistry on FNAC, you know that more in 99% of these will be a malignant lesion. And not only that, they would have a possibility of being a more higher virulent cancer, which might lead you to possibly doing a total thyroidectomy. It is not yet proven that you will do it, but these are in pipeline, and in future, we will look at these mutations and not just the age and the size of the lesions. So you need to understand that BRAF is also used for prognostication as along with TERT mutations. So we know that a patient who is BRAF positive and has got a TERT mutation has a very high likelihood of having a more aggressive disease and will require more aggressive treatment. Now, these are the genetic testings used world over today for a FLUS. You have got the FMR gene testing, which rules out whether this is a malignancy. And you have ThyroSeq, which actually looks at all the genetic malignancies in a next-gen sequencing panel to rule in. That means it looks out for a malignant lesion. Now, having done all this, you have another patient coming to you and he's got a 1.5 centimeter lesion and it shows as a papillary thyroid cancer, Bethesda 6. Now, again, a 1.5 centimeter lesion, it's been debated world over whether you should do a total thyroidectomy or a hemithyroidectomy. On the other hand, you have a 54-year-old female, 8 centimeter nodule, follicular variant of papillary C8 thyroid. The CT scan looks very ugly. Again, in this case, there is no doubt you should offer this patient a total thyroidectomy. So risk stratification is very important because it helps to tell you whether your patient is going to do well and how you're going to possibly treat that patient. This data from MSKCC has shown how the age, the gender, the tumor size, and extra thyroid extension plays a vital role in how your patients will behave. So that's how they came across with prognostic factors. So there have been umpteen number of prognostication factors, and the most commonly used is your LAHES, which uses the age, metastasis, extension, and size. Now, what I would urge all of us to do is use the TNM classification, because it is very vital that whenever you're dealing with malignancies, you stage the patient so that for future, we know exactly what was the presentation and how the treatment was used in this particular patient. What is important to note that only in the TNM of thyroid cancers does the age have a play a role. And today, in the 8th edition, 55 years is taken as a cutoff, changing from the earlier 45 years. So you have this major change of age. And besides that, you have got the lesions which are coming on to the superior mediastinal nodes being categorized as N1A. So again, 55 years and then the other factors. So what happens in a low risk patient, less than 55, you have a risk, death of risk of 1%. Anyone at intermediate risk and high risk goes from 15% to 54%. This is of importance because you need to counsel your patient. Most of our patients are going to be low and intermediate, and you know that your 85% of your patients are going to survive. Now, the same dilemma, are you going to do a hemithyroidectomy or a total thyroidectomy for a patient who is 4 centimeter? As we discussed, 1.5 centimeters and below, no doubt you're going to do a hemi. More than 4 centimeters, there's no doubt. Between 1.5 and 4, there is a dilemma. So the debate is that low-risk patients have 100% survival and the high-risk patients have a 50%. So the concern is that the intermediate risk patient of low age with a tumor which is intrathyroidal but more than 1.5 centimeters, you do not know whether you should do a total or a hemi. So the arguments in favor of a total thyroidectomy are that if you do a total thyroidectomy, you will avoid this local recurrence of 14% in the contralateral lobe and in regional recurrences. And those in favor of hemithyroidectomy say that, okay, you might have a recurrence, but that doesn't really change the long-term outcome. And you can always go back in and operate and, you know, salvage the patient. The incidence of a recurrence on the contralateral lobe is extremely low. And the role of adjuvant therapy today is not yet properly defined. So what we need to look, when we look back at data, this MSKCC did a match pair analysis and they found that the local failure rates were almost the same with hemi or a total. The regional recurrences also were lesser in lobectomy and distant metastasis didn't change. So truly your patient is not going to do badly if you are going to treat the patient with a hemithyroidectomy. So by the 2015 guidelines today, less than 4 centimeters low risk unifocal interthyroid lesion should go for a conservative hemithyroidectomy. Rest all patients should be treated with a total thyroidectomy. Now, when we were training, we hardly did or pay attention to the neck node, neck dissection, unless the patient had large neck nodes. So today, when you have a 20-year-old who comes to you with a 2 centimeter thyroid lesion, but has got a right level 4 lymph node seen on ultrasound and diagnosed, what then should be your type neck dissection? You need to understand, as I mentioned, you need to classify them as N1A and N1B. N1A is where the lesion, the lymph nodes are in level 6, that's in the paratracheal region, pretracheal, paratracheal or prelaryngeal, and the superior mediastinal nodes. The N1B is metastasized to the unilateral or bilateral or contralateral cervical lymph nodes. So which of these patients will have lymph node metastasis? Papillary thyroid cancers have upwards of 85%, and the follicular cancers and Hertel cell variants are lesser with 10 to 15%. So how does it matter? Does the age have an implication? So when you look at this data from Blake Cady, you looked at the patients who were between 20 and 40, and the patients who were older, between 60 and 80. As the number of lymph nodes increased from 1 to 3 to more than 10, it didn't seem to matter in the patients who were young. They had 100% survival at the end of 20 years. But when you look at the older population, you look when the number of nodes increase, the patients tend to have a poor outcome. You can see at the end of 20 years, if your patient had more than 10 nodes, he would not live more than 10 years. So then again, this brings into context that not all thyroid cancers are indolent. The number of lymph nodes and recurrence, as you can see, as the number of lymph nodes increase, the possibility of recurrence is increased. It's obvious there are more than 200 lymph nodes in the neck. And if you have a large number of neck nodes being positive, it's possible that you'll miss a few. Again, the size, as the size increases, more than 3 centimeter nodes, you have a higher chance of recurrence. So prognostically, in younger patients, remember, no influence on long-term overall survival. In older patients, presence of large lymph nodes is a poor prognostic marker. And if you have bulky metastasis, there's a higher incidence of distant mets and regional recurrences. So how do you treat them? When you do a central compartment, would you do a central compartment neck dissection? If you have a parathyroid injury and recurrent nerve injury, yes, because the incidence of these is extremely low. When you do a lateral neck dissection, you have a possibility of a spinal axis nerve injury, which is to the tune of 30%, and a chi leak on the left side, majority of about 4 to 8%. So what are the guidelines today? When you look at the American Thyroid Association guidelines, they have not recommended a therapeutic central compartment neck dissection when you have obvious central compartment nodes. And then you have to do a complete compartmental dissection. There is no possibility today of doing berry picking. That means just removing a few nodes. If you have a patient who's T3, T4, then you should do a prophylactic central compartment, irrespective whether they have lymph nodes or not. And if you have a small lesion, a T1, T2 intrathyroid lesion, there is no possibility for doing a prophylactic central compartment. This is a strong recommendation. Means most of the surgeons today would not do a central compartment neck dissection for a very small, that is less than 2 centimeter nodule. What about lateral compartment? Lateral compartment is levels 2 to 5. So you will not do a prophylactic lateral compartment, and you will only do a therapeutic lateral compartment if there are obvious nodes. Why you do not do a prophylactic is because it has very little morbidity, and you can always go back and do a neck dissection if and when the nodes appear. So when you do a central compartment, you need to clear out the entire compartment right from hyoid to the brachiocephalic, from the trachea to the carotids. And the entire compartment including the paratracheal, the pre-laryngeal, and the pre-tracheal have to be removed. When you do a lateral compartment at the end of your dissection, you should have exposed the levels 2 to 5, the entire internal jugular vein, and from the strap muscles to the trapezius. Now, coming to a very unique thing that you all of us will be seeing more often now, an incidentally picked up thyroid nodule. The dilemma is, should you investigate or and do you actually treat them? We know that the patients will come to you with a PET CT finding that there is something up, having an uptake in the thyroid. And almost 1 in 10 of our patients today of breast cancer and thyroid and esophageal cancer come with PET CT scans having something there. So you need to have a proper thought process on how to detect these unusually unsuspected, incidentally detected lesions. So when you have these lesions, remember that the incidence of malignancy differs from 80 to 40%. Remember, if your patient has come to you with a CT, it detects more. And the possibility that those nodules are malignant is very low. It's about less than 10%. However, when your PET detects, it will not detect a lot, but when it detects and it is very focal, you need to realize that almost 40% possibility that you would have a malignancy hub lurking there. So if you have a diffuse lesion, please do not worry, it could be a thyroiditis, but if it's a focal lesion, you should investigate. So if you have a 1 centimeter lesion and above, please evaluate all your cases. If they are less than a centimeter, evaluate only when there is a suspicion on a family history, previous radiation, and history of a thyroid surgery. So you've done your surgery. How are you going to follow up your patients? If you've done a hemithyroidectomy, you need to classify them into low risk or intermediate risk. And you need to consider whether you are going to have or offer them radioiodine, whether you're going to do a suppression, and whether you're going to do anything else. So usually in a hemithyroidectomy, you will offer this patients an ultrasound follow-up and look for the TSH. Your TSH should be below 0.5. When you have done a total thyroidectomy, you should do a follow-up with the thyroglobulin and anti-thyroglobulin. And your ultrasound... Adjuvant radiation may be considered in residual disease. However, there is no current role for any chemotherapy. So when I talked about risk stratification, this is what we need to really look at after you've done a thyroid surgery. If you have done a thyroid surgery, you should look at whether this patient has an intrathyroidal disease or there is anything extrathyroidal. If your patient has an intrathyroidal disease, the age is less than 55, and you have minimal, you have a lesion which has got no capsular invasion and have minimal, that is less than 4 vascular invasion in a follicular thyroid cancer, you know that this is a low risk. On the other hand, if you have a microscopic invasion of tumor into perithyroidal tissue, you have got something which is having radioiodine avidity in the neck, or you have lymph nodes more, which are more than 5 in number, and you know less than 3 centimeters, they fall into the intermediate risk. If they have got large lesions which have got a gross invasion into the perithyroidal soft tissue, an incomplete tumor resection, distant metastasis, they will all be high risk. Why this is important? Because we need to understand today when you would actually give radioiodine. We have taken a step back and looked at which of the patients will actually benefit. So if you have a low risk AT-T1A that is less than a centimeter, uni or a multifocal lesion, you will not offer them post-surgical radioiodine even if you have done a total thyroidectomy. If you have a lesion which is between 1 and 4 centimeter, again, without lymph nodes, there is conflicting data whether this patient will actually benefit. T3 lesions, a lesion more than 4 centimeters, no neck nodes. Again, there is conflicting data whether this patient will require radioiodine. this onwards, low to intermediate onwards, when there's microscopic ETE, generally patients are offered radioiodine. And yet in these group of patients, when there is only microscopic ETA, we really do not know whether this patient will benefit. So what a point I need to bring across is, please discuss with your nuclear medicine doctors, stratify your patients properly, and then discuss whether this patient actually merits a radioiodine therapy. Having given radioiodine therapy and done a total thyroidectomy, how do you know that your patient is going to do well? So we look at the response of radioiodine and the possibility of having a biochemical response. So you're looking at an ultrasound and you're looking at thyroglobulin. So these are two important investigations which will tell you that your patient is under control. So if you have no imaging showing, if you have imaging showing no lesion and you have a thyroglobulin which is less than 0.2, you know that this patient has got no possibility of a disease harbored there, and his chance of a recurrence is less than 1%. If there is some possibility of a thyroglobulin, which stimulated thyroglobulin is more than 10, you know that this patient should be counseled that around 30% of them will develop some structural disease. And we need to observe this patient. You might consider thyroxine, PSS suppression in these patients. When there is a structural disease there, on the other hand, you know that 50 to 85% will continue to have disease in spite of additional therapy. And there's a possibility that they will have locoregional metastasis and distant metastasis. So these patients should be treated more aggressively and followed up more aggressively. And the ones that have indeterminate response, that means now there's a possibility that you are having a lesion which has transformed. Those are the patients which will have a possibility that you might not be able to control them. So the rule of the thumb is you need to do the thyroglobulin and also look at the anti-thyroglobulin at every follow-up. So when we have done a total thyroidectomy and treated the patient with radioiodine, we will follow up these patients every 6 months to a year annually with an ultrasound neck, a thyroglobulin and anti-thyroglobulin. So after before they come to us, we advise them to withdraw thyroxine for 4 weeks and then look at the stimulated thyroglobulin. And we look at whether they were less than 2, 5, between 5 and 10 and more than 10. So what exactly is the goal of our radioiodine? The goal of radioiodine is to destroy any microscopic foci of disease after surgery. And this will help improve the value of thyroglobulin as a marker and increase specificity of radioiodine scanning for detection of recurrence or metastasis. So generally, either you do a dosimetric calculation of what is the remnant there and then give the thyroglobulin radioiodine according to it. But what is generally followed is assessment of whether it's a papillary carcinoma of thyroid with or without lymph nodes and whether there's an aggressive histology. So they give 30 to 50 millicuries for those patients with only residual thyroid ablation. And anyone above that goes to 150 millicuries. Follicular thyroid carcinomas are treated with 200 to 250, and a metastatic disease is treated with 200 to 250 millicuries. So usually you follow up these patients after 6 months after radioiodine, again do a large dose scan, and then again check for thyroglobulin and all after 6 months. You can continue doing this till your patient has achieved a negative radioiodine uptake. This brings us to a very interesting clinical situation where a patient has undergone a hemithyroidectomy. You have counseled the patient that there's your low risk, you're between 18 and 55, your lesion is small, it's intrathyroidal. Now, when your pathologist reports, they tell you that it's a papillary CA thyroid, a tall cell variant. Now, this should actually raise your antenna that this patient has possibly got a more virulent disease. And you need to discuss whether you need to do a completion thyroidectomy or observe. Now, you should do it because when there's a high risk lesion, when there's a multifocal disease, when there was gross excess thyroid or gross capsular breach, which is reported on pathology. If your patient has had a prior history of radiation, which was not documented and now has come up, what we end up doing in most patients is because there's an incomplete documentation and we have a patient who has a risk of poor follow-up. In those patients, we would offer completion today. What we need to understand about this poor prognostic feature of high-grade lesions is that you have a papillary thyroid cancer variants which have poor prognosis because they do not have a possibility of adjuvant therapy. They are undifferentiated variants and they will not take up radioiodine. So your surgery has to be the best the first time round. So a tall cell variant, a columnar cell, and a diffuse sclerosing variant, when they are reported, you need to take steps and do a total thyroidectomy. Now this brings into consideration of the reporting of the pathologist. They write a very big description and this is somewhere hidden inside. Please discuss with your pathologist that if at all you come across this, please bring it to my notice. Because if you miss this, you might have done your patient a disservice. Follicular cancers are of two variants, the microinvasive and the microinvasive. So when you have a widely invasive cancer, there's extensive vascular invasion. There's extensive invasion into extra thyroid because there's a capsular breach. And these are the patients that will do worse. So you today will hardly see a follicular cancer. And amongst them, the widely invasive are very rare. But if I have a 1 centimeter follicular cancer, which is widely invasive, I would advise this patient a total thyroidectomy. And again, there is a term now, the poorly differentiated thyroid cancer, because they're not able to tell you what it is. So the pathologist will report a poorly differentiated carcinoma based on the Turin's proposal, looking at all these features. And this again puts the patient into a possibility that this is a very high risk patient for local recurrence and distant metastasis. A little bit about upper aerodigestive tract involvement. You might have patients coming to you with a fixed thyroid lesion and you should today investigate them with a contrast enhanced CT because you want to look out for the trachea, you want to look out for the esophagus, and this will help you plan your investigations and a treatment. So most of the times, if you have a lesion which is stuck to the trachea and the larynx, you might be able to free it off. So do not plan to do a laryngectomy upfront, but see that you get a proper plane of dissection. These are not invading cancers, they're pushing cancers. They tend to have demineralization. So you can see that we were able to save the part of the hemithyroid cartilage and do a complete resection. A bit about pediatric thyroid cancers. These are aggressive cancers because they tend to have a lot of lymph node metastasis and we need to deal with them very carefully. So they are very aggressive at presentation. Most of the patients present to us with a lymph node, and most of those patients who have large nodal disease like this will have pulmonary metastasis. So when we analyze our data and publish at Tata Hospital, we found that the nodal disease is a harbinger of distant metastasis. 30-40% of these will have a normal X-ray chest. But then when you're done a total thyroid and you send them for radioiodine, they'll pick up a pulmonary metastasis. Now, when you have a pulmonary metastasis or a distant metastasis, does your treatment change? So most of the patients who are elderly will with large nodes, as discussed, they would have a poor prognosis. Why? Possibly because they have distant metastasis. So we need to realize that almost 10% of your patients will manifest with distant metastasis at initial presentation. And most of your patients of follicular and Hürthle cell carcinoma will tend to have some form of distant metastasis. So as I said, we are very fortunate that most of us will be dealing with papillary thyroids, which will have less of these. Majority of distant metastasis occur at a single site. And most common sites are the pulmonary metastasis and the skeletal metastasis. And less than 20% will have multiple site involvement. So when you look at pulmonary mets, you need to realize that there are certain poor prognostic features. More than 40 a poorly differentiated follicular cancer, like the widely invasive ones, non-iodine concentrating mets, associated bone and other metastatic sites. No patient has not received radioiodine or is not possibly responding to it. And there is a local relapse before metastasis. Now, when you look at all these, what brings into focus is this group, the patients who have a normal X-ray chest and who respond to radioiodine. So you have, like I said, you have a pediatric patient who would have a normal X-ray chest, but when you do a radioiodine scan, will have a lung met. Now, these patients tend to have a very good prognosis. A 15-year survival with pulmonary mets is 89%. And normal X-ray chest and partial or no response to radioiodine brings down the survival by almost 90%. So those patients who do not respond to radioiodine tend to have a poor survival. Coming to skeletal metastasis, you would have most common metastasis in the vertebrae, followed by the pelvis and the ribs. And on an average, the survival is about 10 to 30% in these patients. So when you're looking at a patient with skeletal metastasis, what is important is to consider whether this met in the bone is in a weight-bearing structure. Because if there's a possibility of a pathological fracture in a weight-bearing structure, it has implications on the spinal cord and the nerves. And you have a possibility of neurological compromise. So you need to first find out this and then look at whether the patient has pain and whether there is a radioiodine activity. So today, if I have a patient who presents to us with a metastasis in a bone and I'm planning for a total thyroidectomy, what we practice at Tata Hospital is to offer them local radiation. Because remember, when you do a total thyroidectomy, the patient is going to be off thyroid hormones. And that's going to cause a TSH stimulation to these lesions, which will further swell up and cause more complications. So we would consider local radiation and then follow up with total thyroidectomy. If you have an isolated, symptomatic, resectable met, the treatment of choice is surgery. But like I said, if it's in a weight-bearing area or it is around the spinal cord, please consider radiation first. The survival significantly improves if you have offered surgery. So remember that you need to be after your orthopedic surgeons, neurosurgeons. Any isolated metastasis from thyroid cancer should be resected. And that should be the first consideration. Medullary CA thyroid is another type of thyroid cancer that we see. We are seeing about 250 to 300 thyroid cancers in a year and less than 15 cases of medullary CA thyroid. So you know that this is an extremely rare disease. Most of these patients will present to you with lymph node metastasis and about 15% will have distant metastasis. The signs of local infiltration are the dyspnea, dysphagia, and hoarseness. And rarely, they may have ectopic hormone production, which will cause diarrhea, facial flushing, and Cushing syndrome. So you would look out for these when you're having a thyroid lesion. And if you have one of these symptoms, you know that you're dealing with a medullary CA thyroid. Most of the patients have a sporadic thyroid cancer, whereas 20% would be familial. So how do you work up a patient? You work them up with the immunohistochemistry of calcitonin, because you know that calcitonin is expressed in almost 80%. You need to do a serum calcitonin and a serum CEA level. Why CEA? Because this is in a patient who is poorly differentiated or undifferentiated variant. This will be the fact which will tell you clinch diagnosis. You might have a normal calcitonin, but with a raised CEA and an obvious swelling there, you would want the patient to go in for an IHC for calcitonin. As I mentioned, all patients should undergo screening for RET germline mutation, as the incidence of germline mutation in with patients with negative family history is about 10%. So if you have ruled out a RET proto-oncogene, you know that these patients are sporadic. What type of imaging should you do? We talked about ultrasound when we looked at differentiated thyroid cancers. Of course, you will get an ultrasound done first when you are dealing with a thyroid nodule. But you need to do a contrast and CT scan of the head and neck, mediastinum, and the abdomen, because you want to rule out mediastinal lymph nodes, liver metastasis, and pheochromocytoma. You are trying to see if you are dealing with MEN syndrome. If you have a patient who has got extremely high levels of calcitonin, it will be good to consider a DOTA PET if you have the possibility of that, because it will not only give you a good information about the head and neck, mediastinum, and abdomen, it will also tell you about the SSTR, that is the expression wherein you might be able to give this patient octreotide. So how do you treat them? If they're locally resectable disease, this patient undergoes a total thyroidectomy, a bilateral neck dissection. That means a central as well as a lateral dissection. In patients who are familial, you should consider early surgery, because the game is lost the moment you have a disease escaping beyond the thyroid. Now, if you have a patient with a large calcitonin, symptomatic, metastatic disease, what should be the plan? Many people would then call for or consider it palliative. Remember, an operable disease should undergo a total thyroidectomy if you have got a low volume metastatic disease. Please do not give them palliative treatment. Give them radiation to the bone mets. Make them comfortable, but consider removing the thyroid gland and the lymph nodes, because it will prevent them from having a tracheostomy and dysphagia in time to come. So the American Thyroid Cancer Association had a debate about what should be the extent of neck dissection. So if today in practice and in our center, we will do a total thyroidectomy and central compartment clearance. If you have got a very low calcitonin, there are no lymph nodes on ultrasound, that should suffice. However, if the patient has raised calcitonin, we practice central compartment neck dissection and lateral compartment neck dissection. However, internationally, there is no consensus whether the lateral neck dissection is required. If you have a patient more than with a calcitonin more than 200, of course, there is no debate. All the patients undergo central compartment and a lateral compartment neck dissection. Now, the question comes, should I give postoperative radiation? Because there's no much adjuvant therapy in medullary cA thyroids. What you need to understand is that your intent of giving radiation is to achieve local control. That means you do not want disease recurrence back in the neck. It does not improve the overall survival. So today, the recommendation is low that these patients may be offered adjuvant radiation. Remember, radiation causes fibrosis, and in the eventuality that you have some lymph node coming up, you might have a more difficult surgery. So those where there is a risk of an airway obstruction, if the disease comes back, or you're left behind some disease grossly, you should then consider radiation in these patients. So unresectable tumors, macroscopic residual disease, high-risk patients wherein you have scraped the tumor off the trachea, larynx, bulky tumors in the superior mediastinum, and for palliation. This is the current role of radiation. How do you follow these patients? You follow them up with serum calcitonin and serum CA. Now, for every jump of calcitonin, you are not really going to, you know, consider investigation. So there is a concept called calcitonin doubling time. So for which you need four values. So if you have done calcitonin at 6 monthly interval, four times, and you find that it has doubled, then you offer this patient a full investigation again and consider doing surgery, picking up the site of the metastasis. Also, if you have a patient who is symptomatic, as I mentioned, flushing, diarrhea, those are the patients who should be investigated. And today, if you have the possibility of a DOTA PET, you should consider doing that rather than just a contrast and CT. There's a lot of advance in chemotherapy, and what they have found is that tyrosine kinase inhibitors such as vandetanib and cabozantinib are the ones that will actually help the patients. But today we know that only the patients with significant tumor burden and are symptomatic, those are the patients that go in for these therapies. They are expensive and they have a lot of side effects, especially hypertension, which can be malignant. So you need to weigh your options and then consider whether your patient can go in for one of these therapies. Last, I'd like to end with the anaplastic CA thyroid. And all of us have this thought process, is it really treatable? Do you actually do surgery for them? And what are the outcomes? So these are one of the most aggressive cancers in thyroid. They're rare, thankfully, and they often are associated with well-differentiated thyroid cancers. So we now see three types of anaplastic thyroid cancers, one with the thyroid swelling existing and one without. The one with the thyroid swelling existing may have a multinodular goiter or may have harbor a well-differentiated thyroid cancer. These are both curable, treatable. The ones that are de novo are the ones which are dangerous because they come bang, and present to you and the patient dies on you very fast. Thankfully, the incidence is declining because of better iodination of food and aggressive investigations. So remember, your patients will present to you with a rapidly enlarging neck mass. Large amount of them will have lymph nodes, and most of them will have invasion of the upper aerodigestive tract. So you, before you head the path of treating, you need to investigate any sign, any suspicion that you are dealing with a patient having anaplastic CA thyroid should be thoroughly investigated. So if you have a very rare possibility that you have an intrathyroid disease, you should go in for a total thyroidectomy, follow it up with adjuvant radioiodine if there's a well-differentiated component, and radiotherapy, and adjuvant chemotherapy is debatable. On the other hand, if I'm an extrathyroidal disease, you should consider radiation or maybe just palliative chemotherapy. So the ATA guidelines, and this is one document that I would recommend all the consultants to read as well as the residents. Remember, anaplastic CA thyroid are all stage 4 disease. The stage 4A is when it's confined, and stage 4B is when there are some lymph nodes. So if you are able to operate them, then they should go in for surgery followed by radiation plus or minus chemotherapy. If they are unresectable, they should get radiation therapy plus or minus chemotherapy. And if they are metastatic, you should consider them to have palliative therapy with local radiation and systemic chemotherapy. And those of you who do clinical trials, urge these patients to go in for clinical trials. Remember, we know less about these diseases because they are rare. And if we are able to collate information amongst ourselves, we will get more information and possibly understand how to tackle them. So I'd like to leave you with some messages. Please prognosticate and plan your treatment carefully. These are curable cancers and you need to reduce the morbidity. Please perform standard procedures and try to avoid multiple procedures with a proper plan. Have a multidisciplinary team, have a discussion with your pathologist, the radiologist, see that they give you synoptic reports, have a discussion with your radiation colleagues, nuclear medicine doctors. Please document your procedure carefully because that may make the difference between a patient undergoing a completion or not. And please plan the adjuvant therapy, explain to the patient what is its need, because many patients are lost to follow up and then come back with very aggressive disease. Thank you very much, and I hope you had a good learning experience.
So we have a few questions for you, Dr. Prathamesh.
Yeah.
The first question is from Dr. Ashish Varghese, who asks, do you recommend FNAC for nodules less than 1 centimeter in size with no high-risk features?
So as I explained, the patients who are having no history of a high risk, no history of radiation, no possibility of any family history of a thyroid malignancy, those patients we would not do an FNAC unless the ultrasound shows features of high risk.
Okay. Next question is from Dr. Prakash Munka. What is the indication of radioiodine? Which cases do radioiodine must or may not be required? I think you have given it in your talk. Please summarize the reasons.
Can you just repeat it? Sorry.
Yeah. What are the indications of radioactive iodine, and which cases do you radioactive should be given or may not be given or may not be required? Please summarize.
So I would recommend that all of the patients that you operate undergo a risk stratification. So you risk, you classify them into low risk, intermediate, and high risk. The ones that are low risk, that means you have an interthyroid lesion, you have no lymph nodes, or you have lymph nodes which are less than 5 with a microscopic foci, which is less than 2 millimeters in them, or you have got a follicular cancer which is minimally invasive. Those patients do not require radioiodine. The intermediate risk ones that are having microscopic extrathyroidal spread, you have lymph nodes more than 5 in number, you may have a discussion whether or not this patient should go in for radioiodine. Today, if you have lymph nodes, we would offer them radioiodine. If they are don't have lymph nodes and just a microscopic extrathyroidal spread, we would observe them. And all your high-risk patients should go in for radioiodine.
Next question is from Dr. Abhishek Menon. What is the type of neck dissection to be done in case of papillary thyroid carcinoma with clinically evident lateral compartment nodes? Selective neck dissection or MRND?
So please do not use the terms MRND and all. Use the terms neck dissection. And we are using consistently now a central compartment neck dissection and lateral compartment. So when you use the term MRND, it means complete neck dissection. It's a modified radical neck dissection, means levels 1 through 5. Remember, very rarely you have thyroid cancers going into levels 1A and 1B. So for all practical purposes, if you have a lateral compartment that's a level 2, 3, 4 or 5 lymph node, you should do a lateral neck dissection which involves clearing levels 2 through 5.
Next question is from Dr. Sanchika, who asks, is thyroglobulin level in follow-up cases of malignancy affected by the presence of thyroid autoantibodies? If so, how should the interpretation of the results be made for recurrence?
So it is very important. That's a very important question, which highlights the fact that you need to do an antithyroglobulin level estimation. If you have an antithyroglobulin which is rising, you know that your thyroglobulin estimation is not normal, is not correct. You might be having a disease and your thyroglobulin levels are appearing normal. So if you're having an antithyroglobulin, that's a thyroglobulin interference, you need to tell the patient to, you know, follow up again. You need to see that the patient is possibly harboring disease, though thyroglobulin may be normal. So when usually these are the situations where you're done total thyroidectomy, you're given radioiodine, and now you're following up the patient. If your antithyroglobulin levels are high, you know that these patients will tend to have a disease but will not be seen on thyroglobulin. So patients should undergo radioiodine scan. Remember, the antithyroglobulin levels take time to drop between 1 to 2 years. So till that point in time, the patient should undergo a radioiodine scan.
Then next question is from Dr. Deepak Nayak. What is your experience with insular carcinoma?
So the insular carcinomas are extremely rare, and they are a high-grade variant of papillary thyroid. And when you have these diagnoses, you will do a total thyroidectomy for these patients and offer these patients radioiodine in order to pick up the disease in continuity. So usually there is a well-differentiated component as well as the tall cell variants, the insular cell variants that are there. So these patients should undergo radioiodine because there will be an uptake by the adjacent normal thyroid cells. And then by close association, these cells will also be treated. So what we need to understand is that all these variants, which the three variants, as I mentioned, will not have a very good possibility of thyroid uptake because they don't have the thyroid supporter mechanism, iodine supporter mechanism.
Okay. So another question from Dr. Kudush Ahmed. which modality do you consider as a primary imaging to be used in thyroid cancer?
Primary modality would be an ultrasound, and for a medullary CA thyroid, you would combine this along with the CT scan.
Another question by Dr. Dilip Samal. Any role of radioiodine screening after total thyroidectomy in papillary CA thyroid?
Screening as in? I mean, we would want to know if this patient is a intermediate or high risk, does he really harbor metastatic disease? And then we would definitely consider doing a radioiodine scan.
Okay. Last question from Dr. Rohan. Sir, sometimes papillary variant like tall cell are hard swellings. Do we suspect undifferentiated tumor which requires radiotherapy apart from the radioiodine post-operative?
So, we would not base our judgment going by the hard or, by the texture alone, because you can have thyroiditis also presenting to you with a hard nodule. So you would want to consider doing an FNAC, a repeat FNAC, if it is negative. If you are suspecting this to be anaplastic, we would go in for a true cut biopsy, because that's going to give you tissue for diagnosis. And only on pathology, you will have all these diagnoses coming. So that is why when you look at grade, this is not something that you will get on FNAC. You'll know only whether you're having a malignancy or not, whether you're having a papillary cancer or not. You will not know whether it is any other lesion.
Right. No more questions, sir. Any other questions for Dr. Sanjeev? Dr. Haritosh?
Thank you, Ritu.
Yeah.
I had one question. Since Dr. Mohanty also said that ultrasound is very important, and Dr. Pai Prathamesh also said that ultrasound is very important. Can we do ourselves do ultrasound? Because in Germany, the ENT surgeon themselves are doing ultrasound, and they are present for the ultrasound, and they have a training for the ultrasound for the ENT doctors, and themselves they are doing ultrasound.
Yogesh, you need to address it, with all the regulations that we are having with PCP and DT, you won't get an ultrasound machine in your clinic. So that's the first hurdle that you have. Doing ultrasound is not a big deal. All the American Head Neck Society meetings have a thyroid ultrasound teaching course.
Yes.
In Germany, you have got all the doctors trained to do ultrasound. They do their ultrasounds and do before they do a lymph node biopsy. So of course, it is something that a surgeon can practice because it is not difficult, but our regulations prohibit it.
This and the Doppler also, both together. I mean, you can have a course. Generally, in head neck, we require all of that. But as you said, a lot of regulations.
We are having problems having ultrasound in our ICU. Even that ultrasound needs to be regulated. So it is so strict in our country, and this is going to be an uphill task if we have to get the regulations changed.
I understand, because of the gender determination during that is a big problem.
Right.
Dr. Haritosh, any questions for with you? Dr. Mohanty?
I answered quite a bit.
I think both the lectures were so elaborate that already the audience, all questions are answered. And it was a very informative session. Thank you, our eminent faculties, Dr. Prathamesh Pai and Dr. Mohanty, sir. And I also thank our moderators, Dr. Ritu and Dr. Haritosh Velankar, for sparing their time. Any other questions? Or we can... So it was a very informative session, and I thank our faculties and our moderators. And I also thank the AOI president, Dr. Samir Bhargav, and Dr. Bharti, the entire web series, the idea was Dr. Bharti's, and it has been very good experience for the people, a very teaching experience. And our AOI secretary, Dr. Kaushal Sheth, for arranging this along with Dr. Reddy's. I thank Dr. Reddy's for sponsoring this event.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. And just as a last corollary, I would say, like, everybody was involved since the last 24 hours. And that was very interesting. All of them had pitched in with the timeline. And it was nice to integrate our thoughts together. Thanks, everybody, including Ritu, Haritosh, Yogesh, Samir, and of course, Pratimesh.
Thank you very much, Sanjeev.
Thank you.
It was a good compliment.
Thank you,
Sanjeev and Pratimesh, for this excellent session. And thanks to Dr. Reddy's for providing the platform. And we meet again next week, and that will be a session on medical management of vestibular disorders and approaches to the IM. So that's going to be another interesting session. Yep. See you all next week.
Yeah.
Bye.
Thank you. Good night.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Malaysian, everybody. Yeah. Thank you.